announcements that need to be made before we begin the work?
Yes. Nellie's in the hospital with bronchitis, you know, affects her, and Betty's not feeling well, she might have to go to the doctor.
Anything else? Your engineer on vacation in Texas, he's coming home tomorrow. There's something else, we'll be in prayer, we'll begin our, oh, Dan?
I saw the paper this morning, White Roman tonight.
Really? Let's keep the romances in our prayers. Anything else? Let's go to God in prayer. Father, we thank you for this beautiful Wednesday morning, for the opportunity that we have to gather together with Christians to open your word and study your word. I give thanks to you for your son and the sacrifice that he made in our behalf. I pray, dear Heavenly Father, that you would be with Nellie and Betty, that you would bless them and heal them. I pray that you would be with all of those of our number who are sick. And I pray that you would be with the Lomax family, that you would comfort them in the loss. Thank you so much for all the blessings that we have in this life, and all of them are through you, through your Son. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're in Joshua chapter 10 this morning. And the chapter opens up with the king of Jerusalem fearing greatly. And why was he so afraid of it? Why did he have such great fear? Well, he had heard, obviously, what Joshua had done to the city of Ai and to the great city, the walled city of Jericho. And what else was bothering him? Remember at the end of chapter 9 that Gibeon had, out of deceit and trickery, had formed an alliance with Israel that they wouldn't attack and destroy Gibeon. So the king here of Jerusalem realizes that Gibeon was, it says that it was a great city with mighty men. So he was afraid of what was going to happen here, so he decides that he'll go and form an alliance with four other kings. And what's their game plan? They're going to unite and form an allegiance, and they're going to go down and attack Gibeon because of what they had done with Israel and forming the alliance with Israel. So, what happens? What do the men of Gibeon do? Well, they call in their alliance that they have with Israel. They send word to Joshua and say, you know, we're going to be attacked here. We have this alliance of three of your servants. Come down and protect us. So Joshua, what does Joshua do? Don't everybody answer at once. Well, he travels from, where is he at? He's at Gilgal, and he sends his army to Gibeon. And do we know the distance from Gilgal to Gibeon?
It's less than 10 miles, I don't know how far it is.
Yeah, as close as I can tell, I come up with 14 miles. Okay. So he travels, his army travels all night long. Now, 14 miles doesn't sound like a long distance, but, you know, they're probably on foot, they're carrying, you know, their weapons and whatever. So they travel 14 miles, and as soon as they get there, they go into battle. But was it okay with them? God told told Joshua that he said, "Don't fear, because I'll be with you." So what does Joshua do with his army? He destroys this alliance of the five kings and pursues them. And what did the five kings do?
Cry.
They flee. And where do they go?
Cave.
They go to a cave. They hide in this cave. But in the meantime, Joshua is pursuing these armies that have been formed. And there's two miracles that happen. What are the miracles? Anybody know?
Hailstorm.
I mean, I would consider them miracles. One of them, at least.
Hailstorm.
They have a hailstorm. While they're pursuing this army, God causes a hailstorm to come down and slaughters this army, basically. And it says that more of them were killed by the hailstorms than by the edge of the sword. Now, I don't know about you, but I wonder about the logistics here. You know, the hailstorm's on this army that's fleeing, but not on the Israelites. So I would consider that a miracle. You know, this army's fleeing, retreating, and this hailstorm, I don't know what size hailstorm, they had to be big enough that they killed the people, but not the Israelites who were pursuing them. And they're having such a success that what does Joshua ask God to do? The second miracle. He asks God to have the sun and the moon stand still so that they can continue to slaughter. And we've talked about this, how, you know, it seems so terrible that, you know, God would allow these things and even command the Israelites to completely slaughter these people, the Amorites, man, woman, child, everything. So Joshua asked God to stop the sun, stop the moon, and hold time up. And how long did they hold it? How long did God stop?
A day.
It says basically for a day, so that they could continue with this slaughter. And it says that this was written in the book of Jasher, that the sun and the moon stood still. I'm not sure what the book of Jasher is. I guess, from what I can find out, it's a book of poetry that was written, and this account is in that book of poetry. And they said that that's never happened since that day.
I have a footnote that said the Amorites, one of their gods was the sun and the moon. So, I mean, total defeat when they find out that this Joshua has control over their gods.
Yeah.
Or his god has control over their gods.
Now, obviously, you know, this is a psychological effect on them, too, that if they're worshiping the sun and the moon, and here, you know, Joshua commands the sun and the moon to stand still, it had to have some type of psychological effect on this army that worships them, but here, this Israelite has power over them through his God. So I would think that would cause a little bit of uneasiness to see that happen.
So this is the first time that God listened to a person and did what he asked.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he said that was a relevance that he asked him to, and God did it. You know?
Yeah.
So that made him a very important person, I would think. You know, very, you know, Moses, you know.
Yeah.
And you don't get the significance to that, but that's huge.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, for this man to petition God, and God listens to his prayer, asking, you know, this unnatural thing to happen, for the sun to stand still and the moon to stand still, obviously raises Joshua to a position, as you said, almost like Moses.
I also footnote on that book of Jasher, that it was like a national songbook of Israel. I was just thinking about our hymn books, you know, they're like poetry put to music. And they obviously, at this
song about this in their heritage. It's a pretty important thing. Any comments or questions? Down through this part of the chapter or verse 13.
Yeah, a lot of people were wondering about that hailstorm. How could it kill like half a one year or better? When I was up in South Dakota, I pulled up to a motel and I looked at the cars that were parked there. Had dents in it about an inch deep and about the size of a golf ball. Mm-hmm. And I thought somebody took a big hammer and pounded it. And the guy said, no. And he says, I'm sorry. And he says, it was in a hailstorm. Mm-hmm. I thought, and that car, the hood, the top of it, and the trunk was battered in like unbelievable.
Yeah.
Like the size of a golf ball.
Yeah. You know, I don't know that we've seen it, but we've obviously heard, probably seen on television news reports where there's hailstorms and the damage that's done by hailstorms, like you said, the size of a golf ball. You know, could you imagine getting pelted by hailstones the size of golf balls, or maybe larger, so you know, slaughter. Yeah, I've heard that too, Phyllis, that, I don't know, somehow with their computers that they went back in time and that 24-hour period is actually accounted for somehow. I don't know. I have no idea how they would do that or how they would account for that. But, you know, they...
So is it February 29th?
Yeah, maybe that's it. Every 4 years we catch up with that. But, yeah, I've heard that too.
Yeah.
He said at this time the planet Jupiter was out of its normal orbit and went by and had slowed down. You know, I don't know how much validity it is because it's, you know, a minority theory that Jupiter actually slowed the orbit of the Earth for a short time, you know. And it's like, I don't know who it is, but I've heard read that. There's an explanation, and I don't know how true it is, but it's a possibility.
Yeah, and, you know, mankind can come up with all kinds of explanations as to why things happened or didn't happen. You know, if you're a non-believer, obviously you're going to look at it from that side of it and try to prove it. You know, we go back to talking about when the army or when the Israelites crossed the Red Sea and they opened up the Red Sea. As well, you know, springtime or it was fall or whatever, and there's just shallow water, you know, whatever. But, you know, we always look at, if you're a non-believer and you're on that side of it, you're always going to look for an explanation that, you know, counteracts.
Well, who said God didn't use Jupiter? You know, I mean, could God have used Jupiter to slow the earth down or, you know?
Maybe he did. Maybe that's how God, you know.
I mean, physically speaking, something had to have happened to make sure that
the Earth stay as rotation speed without necessary movement, maybe you move backwards for a day or something. We don't know, but if our rotation is off by even a small degree, we are in physically our planet has to remain control because of that.
Yeah, unless God has his hand in it,
yes.
So this is it, which obviously he did, so. Any other comments, questions? Well, they continued to pursue this army, the Amorites, and destroy them. Obviously, they've got them on the run. And what happens to those five kings that are in the cave, that have hidden themselves in the cave? What did Joshua tell them to do with those five kings? Put stones over the mouth of the cave, set a guard, and do what? Get back to the battle. You know, we've got them on the run. We're going to destroy them. And if you look at the rest of chapter 10 here, basically that's what Joshua does, the Amorites. This is total slaughter. You know, he's back to the battle and doing what God has told them to do. He pursues them. They shut up the mouth of the cave. They put the stones. They put a guard. They pursue the retreating Amorite army. And after they finished up, God tells them that he's going to fight for them. Everything's okay. They don't have anything to worry about. They're going to be victorious in this battle. So after the battle's over, in verse 15, Joshua returns and all Israel with him to the camp of Gilgal. And he's going to now deal with those five kings that had formed an alliance against him. So he goes to the cave where the five kings are pulled up, and he has them remove the stones from the mouth of the cave, and he brings the five kings out. And what does he do?
As the commanders put a foot on his neck.
Yeah, he
commanders of the army.
He commands the captains of the army. He brings the kings out. Obviously, he puts them down on the ground. He tells them to put their foot on the neck of the kings. Does anyone know what that what that's all about?
Humiliation.
Well, obviously, yeah. These are kings. This is humiliation.
Dominance.
Domination.
I have it as an ancient custom to show that you're victorious, and then also when it talks about Psalms, make your enemies your footstool, that kind of might be referring to what they did there.
Yeah. This is obviously something that we don't quite understand what they did at that time. But it was showing, that you have power over your enemies. Putting them on the ground, putting the foot on their throat or on their neck, and they're bowed down. Obviously these are kings, these are royal people, and it's humiliation that they're being put on the ground. So what does Joshua do with them?
Hangs them. Yep.
He hangs them on five trees, and how long do they leave them up there? Evening, he takes them down. What's he do with them then?
Put them back in the cave.
Puts them back in the cave that they were hiding in, stones it up, and says that's where they are today, to this day. And then what does Joshua proceed to do? Goes back to the battle. He's got the Amorites on the run, these kings that formed this allegiance. He's going to go in and destroy their cities or whatever they were, the boroughs or that they were in. And he it's like, there's a march through these cities. He just utterly destroys them as he goes. And I think I counted eight different cities or territories that Joshua conquers on his way through here. Anybody count? And he just goes, God tells them that I'm going to be with you, in this process. And he just goes from one to the next, utterly destroying, you know, as we talked about, man, woman, child, livestock, slaughters everything. And, you know, we have, as we talked about, we have a problem with that, that God, a loving God, would command something like that to happen. What do you think about that? I mean, we've kind of talked about this, but how do you feel about that? Does that bother you? Does it bother you that God would command something like that to take place? This kind of reminds me, not to the scale of this, obviously, we're slaughtering all these people, but in our study of Matthew on Wednesday night, well, I've just finished with chapter 20, I think, where the man hires the laborers to go out into his field, and he hires them all different times of the day, and then when he calls them in at the end of the day, he pays them all the same wage, and they're upset about it. We read that and we think, oh, you know, that's not fair. But the people who went out in the morning should have gotten more than the people who were hired at the ninth hour of the day. But, you know, again, the example there is that, you know, God can do what he wants to do. You know, it's symbolic that that's his kingdom. And the one that comes in the last gets the same reward as the one in the first. But we think that's terrible. And we look at this situation with this slaughter, and we think it's terrible, but God had a reason for doing what he did. And obviously that's, you know, we've talked about this, that wouldn't pollute Israel with these traditions and ways of these Amorites and the gods that they worshipped and the, you know, the things that they did. So it wouldn't come in and influence the Israelites.
That would also stop any additional uprisings.
Absolutely.
But I have a footnote saying that these 7-8 countries or lands they took over, they didn't occupy, and later on they had to rebattle with them. Mm-hmm. Because Joshua goes back to that Gilgal.
Yeah.
Instead of occupying that land, it was repopulated by the Amorites and they had to fight again.
Yeah, so obviously there must have been a remnant left somehow. But you know, like Vic said, you know, this is, you don't have any further uprisings. And we see that situation where, you know, if you kill someone in their family, then their family comes back and retaliates later. That you've got that revenge, that hatred later. So God says, destroy them. Destroy everybody. Mm-hmm. You know, so there's no problems. There's no future issues. There's no, you know, you're not going to be influenced by the lifestyles that these people live, by the things that they do, by the gods that they worship. So destroy
it. Just think of Joshua's soldiers' constant battle, mm-hmm. that they were able to maintain their physical stamina or something like that.
Yeah, and I don't know the time frame here that these battles went on, but when it started, when they went up to Gideon, remember, they had traveled 14 miles. They had traveled up to go into this battle. And then it sounds like, you know, they just went from one battle to the next. And it, you know, as you said, Vic, how, if nothing else, emotional stress, where you're going in and just slaughtering these people. And they did it, you know, they didn't do it with, you know, a rifle or whatever, shooting people. I mean, it was like close combat contact where you're slashing these people and cutting these people with a sword. So the emotional factor that it had to be on an army, plus the, you know, tiring of battle from one to the next, from eight to different cities. Fred?
Well, the on, I don't like the host, but it says, let nothing undone of all that the Lord commanded Moses. So if we go back and look at what was commanded of Moses, this all might make relevance why they destroyed everyone. Mm-hmm. Because it is hard to see several things through here. It says, without mercy, as the Lord had commanded Moses. And he's fulfilling a prophecy, is what he's doing here. So, you know, that kind of explains why they destroyed everyone.
This goes back to a promise or a covenant between Moses. And the
Israelites. So the next chapter, it tells you.
You know, we have no problem with God just punishing people after they die. You know, if you're an evil person, obviously you're not going to be in the sight of God for eternity. You're going to be condemned. And this is all he's doing. I mean, these were evil people, so he was condemning them right there by using man or Joshua's armies to do it.
And I don't know what type of judgment these people have with God. Not God, I don't know. I don't know how he dealt with these people as far as judging them. But, Don?
You know, we have a loving God, but the Bible is our learning about God. He is a loving God, but he has his anger, his vengeance is really. He's showing us how bad it's been to be for us, for sinners. Now, that's what this is all about. The Bible is teaching us about God's love and his anger, too, his wrath. Mm-hmm. The wrath of God is something to fear.
Well, we know that our God is a loving God, but he's also a jealous God. And one of the problems with the Amorites was the false gods that they were worshiping. And putting up, you know, as their gods. And I don't think that he wanted, you know, this influence on his people because he was a jealous God. He was the God. He was their God. And that's who he wanted them to worship. And he didn't want them seeing, you know, we talk about the sun and the moon, their gods. And they had many gods that they, you know, put up altars for and worship. So I don't think God wanted that influence on his people, his Israel. He wanted them to know that I'm your God. And he obviously said that he would protect them. You know, he told Joshua all through these battles, don't worry, I'm with you. You know, I'll protect you. I'll bring you through it. So he wanted them to know that he was the one, he was their God. Right.
These people had an evil religion. And you could almost call it satanic because they had male and female prostitutes. And they would burn their children as offering to the gods. So, you know, it's like, it's not even like, you know, polytheistic like the Romans and Greeks where they didn't do that stuff. These people did a lot of evil, hateful things, you know. I mean, the burning of the children wasn't the only human sacrifice they practiced, you know.
Right.
They did a lot of things and they were evil people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And I, you know, we look at them and say, oh, that's terrible that he did that. Look at the practices that they had and what they did, that they were evil. And again, I don't think that God wanted his people influenced in seeing this wickedness and evil that these people practiced.
There's,
to
this day, there's problems over in the areas. They both believe that God is once and all.
Maybe
God is using America to utterly destroy.
I don't know. we see at the end there in verse 43 that Joshua returned and all Israel with him to the camp of Gilgal, and says that they were successful. Look at verse 42, all the kings in the land that Joshua took at one time, because the Lord God of Israel fought for Israel. So they were blessed by God. God was with them. He fought for them and protected them, and that's why they were successful in the campaign here in those battles. Any other questions, comments?
What does that do for each of us in that? Does this show us the power of God in everything of our lives, in all aspects of our lives today? Because here, Joshua tells the men, have good courage, don't be afraid, because the Lord is going to do this to every one of your enemies. Verse 25, where it talks about it.
Right.
And he does that. And he fulfills his promise. So we have to look to God as a God that's going to be, fulfilling his responsibility to mankind. And what does that do for us today? How does it help us to be encouraged to serve the Lord?
Well, I mean, just as God provided and took care of these people at this time. Now, you know, a little different situation. These people were fighting the war in battle. I think God does that for us today. I think he protects us. I think he watches out for us. The problem that we have is, you know, we have our will. We want things to happen this way. We want this to happen. We want this to be done. And when it doesn't, then we sometimes question, but, you know, you got to have that relationship with God and trust in him that what's happening in your life is going to come out okay.
Yeah.
If you have that relationship.
Well, I think this Old Testament example here is helping us to see how God is with us continually. He was with them, and he didn't back down. He fulfilled exactly what he said he'd do,
right.
And he was going to kill all of their enemies. Mm-hmm. So we have an enemy today, which is the Satan existence.
Yeah.
And we've got to learn to say he has no effect on me because the Lord is with me.
Yeah. And you know, being in the physical body with the spiritual, we sometimes have problems with that.
Yeah.
You know, we, like I said, we want things to come out a certain way. We want things to be positive. We want, you know, this, we want that. And sometimes we don't get that. But, you know, we still have to maintain that and believe that whatever God is doing for us, he's doing it for our benefit. You know, how many times have you wanted something? You really want this, and you didn't get it. And then later you find out, well, it's a good thing that I didn't get that, because things worked out, you know, better in my life because I didn't get it. I wanted to go this way, but God's directed me this way, and this way turned out better than what I wanted. You know, has that happened in your lives? It has in mine, I know that. So, you know, you got to keep that relationship. We're not always going to get what we want, but we have to trust that what God is putting in our lives is right for us. You know, how many times have you seen, you know, Christians at different states? Some are blessed with everything. And others are struggling. And it's not that one's better than the other. And I can't explain that. I don't know why. But, you know, that's God's will. And you've got to maintain that relationship. You know, some people have sicknesses. Some people don't. You know, I can't explain. I'm not God. But God knows. And, you know, he tells us that he's not going to allow us to be tempted more than what we can stand. So the terrible things that come into our lives, you know, aren't going to be more than what we can stand. There's always going to be a way out, but in this physical body, and we just don't see that. We want what we want. Anything else? Any other comments, questions? Our time is up. Terry will be back next week, we're willing, and we'll pick up with chapter